material, because one of the things I find as both as a parent and then as a parenting consult is sometimes we overcomplicate things and are looking for new innovative shortcuts, when the reality is an awful lot of what we do is very consistent. It's just really about how do we evolve and transition as our kids grow older. Now, before we get started, I want you guys to think about one thing here for a moment. I want you to think about a personal example of some interaction with your seventh grader that at that moment was infuriating and really emotional. It could be even just crisis, like very worrisome, very scary. Something really intense that now or a little while later you could look at and kind of chuckle at, or it became a great story to share with people, very self-deprecating in nature. So I want you to think of something like that, something that in the moment it felt really worrisome or concerning, but later on you can kind of chuckle and it's a great story you tell to your girlfriends or other family members. I want to make you all aware, coming up in a few weeks, it's a Friday. We do twice a year, we do a free conference at Southeast Psych where we make a number of clinicians available to give a kind of talk like this, a free 1 hour talk on a particular topic. It's the 21st from 9 to 12. We're going to have 12 different topics. I know Emma Kate's going to be co-presenting on anxious teens and how to help cope with that. I'll be talking about one of my areas of specialty, drugs and alcohol. And just sort of how do you parent in the age of marijuana and heroin, and how to be a more informed parent along those lines. We don't require registration, but space is limited. So if you find a topic that you're really interested in, my recommendation would be come early. We'll do kind of same day registration, and once the number of available seats are taken up in a room, that's just sort of, at that point you might have to go with your plan B. And we'll make sure that we send flyers and information about this conference to the appropriate people here.
And I've been to these before, and they're really good. They're very good. It's really.
So I want to tell you guys, I had you think a little bit about your own example of a thought about a crisis that later on became very funny. So in the fifth grade, up until the fifth grade, my mom cut my hair, and she cut it in a way that I hated. So I was already, as a little kid, kind of self-conscious about having a big head, and then back in the 80s, the haircut would be over the ears, and it was very huge. Like I probably had a little bit of like infant body dysmorphia. Like I assumed I had Charlie Brown-sized head. And so I always told my mom, Mom, I want my hair to look like all my friends, and they have it sort of like tapered, and it's around their ears, and it looks really cool. My mom would always say this, no, your ears will stick out. I mean, that was just sort of the answer. And so me being the industrious young kid that I was said, well, I'm going to do it myself then. I'm going to kind of cut around my ears and make it kind of shaved. But I didn't have a razor. So the only thing we had was one of my older sister's razors that she kind of shave her legs and her armpits with. So as a fifth grader, I said, well, I don't want it bald, so I'll just sort of nick the tips of every kind of hair and kind of get that faded, tapered look. And I don't know how much time transpired before I started to feel how smooth and consistent it was, and I started to feel certain spots that really didn't have any hair whatsoever at the time. And so by the end, it very much looked like I was a Hiroshima survivor in terms of how I did a number on my hair. But my mom, graciously in the fifth grade, we swooped out, we got, and at the time this was very novel, but your own home haircut kit. So it had number of different types of scissors and clippers with all different types of, and that was pretty cool and not something that a lot of my friends had. Well, fast forward to the seventh grade. So now I get my hair cut the way I want, but me being kind of the diva that I was, still my mom just couldn't do it the way that I wanted it to. So she was cutting my hair in the seventh grade, and I just kept complaining, like, Mom, you're not doing it right. Like, the fading doesn't look as smooth. Like, I can tell one side is uneven from the other. And my mom was very much sort of a no-nonsense person, but she also didn't really kind of take the bait. And then finally, because I didn't get sort of a rise out of her, or she wasn't really considering my complaints, I called her a name that you shouldn't call anybody, but you certainly shouldn't call a woman, that you certainly shouldn't call your mother. And so right in the middle of her cutting my hair, she just dropped everything. She said, I'm never cutting your hair again until you apologize. So my mom never cut my hair again, because as a seventh grader, some of you may be able to relate with your kids, it's like logic and reason and morals and values sometimes is superseded by stubbornness. And I was like, fine, I'm going to learn how to cut my hair again, myself. And now that I had the actual equipment, I did. And to this day, my mom and I will talk about that, but still, my wife will say, you really never actually apologized to your mom for saying that. And I'm like, yeah, you're right, I haven't. It's crazy being a middle schooler, right? The reason that I use that illustration is, one, is so you know that I'm not this super, super adult, or I was not a super teenager. I was a punk in seventh grade, but a punk that my mother loved enough to kind of cut my hair until I crossed the line that I wouldn't backpedal. But we ask ourselves, so how do we parent middle school? Because middle school is this really awkward phase. And all of you know this. So a lot of what you're going to hear tonight is going to be hopefully more validating and affirming rather than novel and like I've never thought of that or I've never heard that before. But one of the challenges is our kids think about life more in terms of their age rather than stage. I'm 12, I'm 13, I'm in the seventh grade, I'm a middle schooler, or I'm firstborn, or whatever that may, I get all A's. They think more in terms of age and accomplishment rather than, as parents, we need to think more in terms of developmental stages, especially during these years because puberty is erratic and unpredictable. So two kids can be in the same class, can have the same birthday, and one looks like they should be shaving daily, and the other one, you're wondering if they're still wearing training diapers because of the physicality even difference. But the other is this, most of puberty is internal. We don't see it. We can't predict it or anticipate it. Oftentimes we just have to respond to it. And depending upon our own emotional intelligence, that can sort of be explosive. So they're in this transition where they're no longer a kid. But they're not an adult. And so they need some consultation of how do you navigate this time and this transition, because they're making it up as they go. And a lot of times what they believe they're entitled to doesn't match up with their track record or some of their capability. You guys already know this. Once you, at some certain point, you recognize not only are they changing, but the nature of my relationship with them is changing. Our communication, how we talk, what we talk about with one another, how much or how little time we spend with each other, the things we used to like to do together were no longer as available. So one of the parts about raising a teen, and for many of you, you recognize this, you're in the throes of it, or you may have already had some experience with previous kids, is this is just as much of a little bit of a grieving and celebration process, because you're starting to get a glimpse of who they're meant to really be versus when they're really young, it's mostly about potential and dreams and hopes and what we aspire for them to be. But this whole idea of like if they're jumping into this young adulthood early stage, it really is about how do we let go, accept and celebrate the things we can't control as a parent. Now having said that, kids will always want to leap forward more in terms of freedom and independence and autonomy. And what we want to make sure of is that even if they're changing, this idea of parenting, we want there to be this balance. We want that balance to be what they've already demonstrated good behavior, good choices, and a good track record in, and have that be sort of tempered by how big of a leap of faith that we do and give them as they're stepping into this new phase and stage of life, because they want more space, they want more privacy, they want less monitoring or supervision or being directed, and it's a give and take. Now again, if we think about this from a stage developmental perspective rather than age, just because they're in seventh grade, or just because their friends get this curfew, or just because their friends has this amount of technology, or just because their friend, you know, is able to do this on the weekends, it's really about their developmental stage, what they have already demonstrated, trustworthiness and good behaviors around, and what are the things that they've demonstrated they struggle with or they have a poor track record with, versus just simply how they might think, which is, I'm a seventh grader, I'm no longer a kid, stop treating me like a baby. Now, one of the key components of parenting that I always ingrain in both the clients that I see, the young people I see, and their parents is that independence and maturity, you have to give both sides of the coin. So if you want the good stuff, you have to take the bad stuff with that as well. So you want freedom? Great. That comes with responsibility and accountability. You want to have the opportunity to make choices? Great. Then you have to be accountable for your poor choices and live with the consequences of that. And so a lot of times, both parents and kids, so pretty much the gamut of humans, we want the good stuff and we want to kind of put away the things that don't work for us. But anytime you're developmentally transitioning, you're shaking the status quo. And you can anticipate with your kids, they will push back on the status quo when it doesn't work for them. And so part of the acceptance of this period of becoming a new teen is that conflict does tend to increase, because when you have to take the good with the bad, anybody is going to push back of, well, no, but that's where I want you to be, mom, or that's where I want you to be, dad, or that's where I want you to kind of take care of me. And it doesn't work that way. And it especially doesn't work that way, we're going to see in a moment, because we need to be sending a consistent message of what's the point of this period. And the point of this period is to move them one step closer to responsible, independent young adults that understand how the real world operates and the best way that they can operate as a young adult in the real world, versus up until this point, a lot of times it's how they operate within the family unit, how they operate in the Heatherly household, because I'm primarily responsible for them when they're little kids. But more and more, if they want to become independent, more and more, if we want them to take ownership in their life, it becomes, how do you conduct yourself in the real world where mom and dad don't rescue you, mom and dad don't dictate, control, or supervise every single thing. Now, whether it's a college conference that I did this summer, whether it's last week when I was speaking to the 11th grade parents at Country Day, or whether it's here, I always ask this question whenever I give talks early in a semester or year. It's like, what's your goal for this year for your kid? What's your goal for this semester? You'd be surprised how much conversations can go into the next 5 or 10 or 15 years, and the biggest worries, or already have figured out what they're going to do or what they should do. I kind of want to slow down and say, wait a minute, what's your goal for them just in the next few months? Maybe to the end of this calendar year, maybe this first semester, maybe for this entire 7th grade year. What do you want for them? Because a lot of times, if we don't stop and figure that out, we just have this long view of what we want for our kids. It can be really difficult then to, well, how do you then you create a strategy and a rubric to help them be successful? And how do you know that they're moving in the direction that you want for them? That's a challenge for teens, because the way their brain operates is it's very difficult for them to consistently think about the real life implications of today or tomorrow. And if the way we communicate with them is like, but in 5 or 6 years, you know, this may impact your college, that's really a very difficult way to try to capture their motivation and attention. Versus, what do we want this year? So let's take a little bit look at what we know about this generation that's probably a little bit different than when you and I were growing up in middle school. One of the biggest changes is 30 years ago, puberty was happening about 18 months later than it is now. In fact, in the 1850s, puberty was happening around age 17 for women and around 18 for boys. And so that's why they came up with this great sex education program called Get Married Once You Start Having Sexual Feelings. But even in the 80s, it was 18 months ago. Now, it's on average, girls start puberty around 10 and a half, and boys are around 11 and a half. And so what we're recognizing is childhood is actually it's shortening up. And that has nothing to do with so much with kind of the culture and environment we create as parents for them. It's biologically and physiologically some of the hormonal and emotional dysregulation and some of the brain growth that's happening sooner. The honeymoon period isn't as long as maybe it was for you and I. But what we also know is that every year, incoming college, they get surveys and to kind of get an idea of each year of potential leaders. And right now, our young people are kind of hitting it out of the ballpark on rates of narcissism, self-absorption, the emphasis on fabricating or creating their own persona, the amount of time that they're preoccupied by what other people think about them. And we're also seeing some decrease in some of those traits we normally would say kind of counterbalance narcissism, like empathy and care for others. Now, I work with young folks, and they have a lot of strengths that we could spend a whole week talking about. But I think it's important for us to highlight that there is some things that are happening with this generation for a number of reasons where they are a little bit more full of themselves than past teenagers in the past. And we're sort of seeing how that's impacting our culture and how that's impacting parents. And how do we effectively kind of parent them during this time? One of the things if we look at is this is even 2 years old, but how much time our culture is tied and wrapped around technology and social media. From a teen's perspective, what we know is that they spend about 53 hours a week in front of a screen. But anytime they're in front of technology, it's common that they actually have two or more technological platforms that they're utilizing at the same time. They may be listening to music on their phone while they might be watching a YouTube video on a tablet or a laptop. And so the reality is when you take all of the technology that they digest over the course of the week, it's about 77 hours in the course of a week that they get. And so we know that this generation doesn't know what it's like to not grow up with a smartphone or even a cell phone. And they may not even have heard, like, what is a landline or what is a cord? You know, did you ever have to call it a cordless phone? I mean, did they ever have cords? So even when we think about this, one of the challenges that parents sometimes have is they feel like they don't have as much leverage around technology because we are becoming a technologically savvy and dependent culture. More and more schools are adapting technology and computers and tablets as a way to access homework and do education. And that's great for 92% of the population, but about 8% are kind of wired to where their brains just cannot manage that availability. And oftentimes I work a lot with addictive behaviors and traits with kids, a lot of times with guys, especially that if you let them, they'll play 40 hours of video games a week. And so even though they're changing into this period of becoming a teen, the model is always you want to create boundaries and limits. Now, as a parent, I never take away your right to set those. It's really a question of what guides your principles in implementing boundaries and restrictions. I'll give you a couple examples. So in my household, I have a 13-year-old and a 10-year-old, both girls. We create boundaries and limits around organization priorities. As number one is that technology and fun always comes after your responsibilities. So on any given day, they have to do their homework first, and any kind of chore or way they contribute to the family and the home first. And then they have access to it. But they also have curfew. So they have a curfew where they turn in all of their technology as well. And on the weekends, it's a little bit different. But on the weekdays, we really don't have to monitor, are they getting too much? But here's the philosophy we've always taken, is that, well, they've demonstrated good choices around technology, they've demonstrated immaturity and kind of going overboard, but we'll use that as a motivation of the more efficient you become in terms of taking care of your chores, doing your homework, the incentive is you may get a little bit of extra time to be able to be on YouTube or to talk with friends, because it's based upon that extra amount of time is how quickly you can take care of your responsibilities. You can't do that when it's the other way around. You give them the fun first and then they have to take care of, you lose that leverage. But we also create restrictions, limitations on the number of apps, the number of social media apps. Why? Because as a parent, we believe that we are responsible to monitor their activity around that. And so I don't want to have to monitor four or five different social media apps. So, you know, she has Instagram, she has Kick, because one of her friends, it's for doesn't have an iPhone, and so it costs money for them to text. But she'll come regularly, say, can I have Snapchat, or can I have this, or can I have that? And I'll be like, why? And without a great reason, or without, well, which one are you going to give up then? Because we're only going to allow a certain number of apps, certain number of games. Why? Because we don't want to get in that idea of just accumulating for accumulation's sake. That's more that we have to monitor. And then the other thing we do on the weekends is we don't place such a hard limit on the amount of time so much as breaks, to where there's a certain amount of time and then you have to go do something else. You have to get off tech. So there may be days where, you know, I think it was Labor Day weekend, our family binge watched Stranger Things together on Netflix, but we would watch 2 or 3 episodes, then we go, all right, let's all go do something. Let's go walk the dogs together. Let's all go make lunch or something to eat. And then we would kind of come back. So the idea is to break it up so that we have other activities and things that we're really interested in and can carry us. Now, so we talked about puberty's happening earlier. We talked about kids' levels of narcissism is going up, but we're also coming out of this age of anxious parenting. And there's a number of reasons around this. But what we've really seen is that parents, just because they're able to, have kind of gone a little bit overboard about the amount of time and preoccupation they have around their kids. And we're starting to see some of the downfall for that. We're seeing kids on the one hand that, or parents that have this perception that things are really worse off than they actually are. You know, did you know that you're more likely for a cow to kill you than a terrorist attack or being killed by a shark? And yet, it's so easy to get wrapped up in just the negative bombardment of social media and other things that we overestimate the threats. And a lot of times as parents, very well intentioned, what that tends to result in is we step in a little bit more and monitor and direct and control a lot more than maybe you can remember your parents doing for you. Is the world scary? Yes, but the world has always been scary. In fact, it's never been a safer time to be a kid and grow up. Crime is down, violent crime with youth is down, drugs and alcohol minus marijuana, and then heroin tends to fluctuate a little bit, but it's more of a problem on the adult level than the teenage level, is down. Bullying is down to 1/3 of what it was about 30 years ago. Less kids or teenagers are engaging in sexual activity. Like, all the metrics are steadily declining, and yet 70% of the American public believes that the media is actually underreporting the threats that our kids face. So with that has created a couple problems. One is that this generation of teens is the most anxious generation that we've ever seen. And 3 years ago, for the very first time, teens reported higher levels of stress and anxiety than adults, for the very first time. Now, does that mean that they're struggling and suffering with anxiety, or is it just in their head? And the answer is yes. The answer is yes. Now, this generation of kids have never grown up not knowing Columbine or Sandy Hook or 9/11. So when you think about some of those things that kind of rocked our world growing up, they've never known a world without them. Now, I remember doing, this may, you know, date me, but I remember early on in elementary school doing tornado drills, and then I think once or twice before someone said, listen, it's the 80s, doing like nuclear, like attack drills. But then that was just like once or twice, and then eventually life went on. But what we've seen is that there's an elevation of both actual mental health and mental illness, but we're also getting better at identifying it. And we're also getting better at early detection and early intervention. But the reality is that this generation is struggling, and a lot of times if we're not mindful of it, everybody pays for it a little bit later on. So I tend to work a lot with predominantly that transition of high school to college, young adults. And right now, a typical teen has a 1 in 6 chance of failing out of college after the first semester. They're not able to handle independent living on their own. And part of that has to do with how anxious they are. The other has to do with how much parents throughout this period are doing for them, that in a lot of ways they don't have an opportunity to kind of refine and figure out until they leave the home. So we create what's called this anxiety, adolescent anxiety trap. They want to be independent, but they're very stressed and fearful of making mistakes, and when bad things happen or when the plan doesn't follow through, there's a lot of confusion of, well, who's to blame? You know, who's responsible for things not going the way that we all envisioned or hoped that they would be? And so that's what we're seeing with a generation that feels anxious and narcissistic, which oftentimes creates this thing that you've probably heard a little bit of. It's called entitlement. They feel very entitled, because what that means is they have this expectation of how life should be, but it doesn't match with the amount of responsibility and ownership that they believe they carry in their own life. So, what does that mean for us? Well, part of it is, if the reality, all the metrics and data suggest that it's never been a safer time to parent, is your parenting guided by fear, anxiety, and worry? Are you allowing your kids to make mistakes? Are we micromanaging them? How much do we create space for them to take some things on? One of my mantras is, are we starting to pass the baton to them? Because psychology verifies that resilient parenting is much more effective than helicopter parenting. Helicopter parenting is this myth that parents can foresee and avert all of the setbacks, adversity, and disappointments. Resiliency says we use those as an opportunity to grow and to learn and then to change behavior so we don't repeat that. But in order to learn from mistakes, your kids have to be able to make what? Mistakes. And in order for them to make mistakes, it has to be them, not the parents, that make the mistake. Otherwise, that again creates that sense of entitlement where it's my parents that are the ones that are unreasonable. Or you may have heard this, I hear this pretty much every day with my clients, my parents are stupid. I have stupid parents. They're idiots. They don't know what they're doing. But with that mindset, what they start to internalize is the quality of my life is not based upon my own choices. It's based upon my parents and the choices or intelligence that they have. And we used to not deal with this as much when they were little, because even from a physical standpoint, we would lord over them, and that would sort of exert some of our authority. But more and more as they get older and more they recognize, my parents sometimes don't say the same thing consistently, or they sometimes start to identify the loopholes in our message, in our parenting, we lose some of that automatic authority and weight that our voice has with them. But part of it has to do with the brain as well. And so one of the things we know about the brain is that the adult brain isn't fully formed and grown until mid-20s. And there's about three major growth spurts that the brain will have during the course of adolescence and teenage. There's a good chance that your kids are going through one of those right now. And what we know when that happens is that the frontal cortex tends to be what starts to grow more, and then we revert a little bit more to the amygdala. So the frontal cortex, that's where short-term memory, impulse control, the ability to learn from past behaviors and patterns, that develops later in life. And so as it's going through a growth spurt, guess what? It's not as consistent and reliable to access from that. So that's why we see kids, that teenagers, a little bit more impulsive. Why we say, I've told you this a million times, why don't you remember this? Or for them to kind of act first and think 12, usually not second. Because that part's growing and it's less reliable. So what happens during the teenage years? More often, they start to process decision-making through the amygdala. The amygdala develops early in life. That's our fear response. Right? You never have to teach a child or an infant how to be scared. You have to teach them security and safety. But what that really represents is a very adrenalized, gut reaction, impulsive decision-making process. That's how their brain tends to work. And so one of the challenges, even as you're starting to try to identify what's realistic for your seventh grader, is that their brain does not function like yours and mine. And it's not necessarily because of their value or their feelings about you that they sometimes say very impulsive and emotionally inappropriate things to you. Now, hopefully, unlike me, your kids will apologize to that. But it's not because all of a sudden your kid is horrible or mean. or they've lost kind of that moral compass. A lot of times it's their brain. But we also, and we'll talk about this here a little bit, but have we also then helped them develop and learn, like, what do you do when you get in your own way? And this developmental period kind of creates more collateral damage for you. The other thing to think about, and this is important as you start to identify, like, well, where do I start giving them a little bit more independence? Where do I keep boundaries and limits? Is this idea of synaptic pruning. And so synapses are the ways that the brain kind of attaches to different parts and sends messages, really creates habit. And what starts to happen during this adolescent teenage years is that the parts of the brain that are not being consistently activated and utilized, the brain will prune those synapses. And so then it will redirect some of that energy and focus to the parts of the brain and activities that are regularly being activated and utilized. And what that means is this, and this may be good news or bad news or a little bit of both for the audience here, is that things that your kids tend to do, or it's a habit now, they're shaping their brain for that to become very habitual and instinctual and effortless later on as adults. But those things that they struggle with right now, if those parts of their brain are not being consistently activated, there is the possibility that synaptic pruning will continue to make that harder and harder for them in years and years to come. We see this a lot of times with teens that are not particularly active. And so the way that their reward system of their brain, how they feel enjoyment and pleasure, is through very sedentary, kind of sit in front of the video game, zone out. If that doesn't change, there's a good chance that that's how their brain is always going to be the first thing they think of. It's like, what do I want to do when I want to relax? What do I want to do when I decompress? Somebody that's active and they recognize, like, going outside or running or reading a book or something, walking the dog, it makes me feel better. The brain can really shape that to where that will consistently be the way they process stress relief later on in life. So there is some importance of their habits right now because they can be shaping how their brain works. Now, again, if we do this age versus stage, for those of you that have boys, young little dudes, the recognition that they develop a little bit behind in a lot of ways than girls. And we've seen this in a number of ways. By the sixth grade, girls have 90% of their adult height. You know, I had a friend that at age 24, a guy grew 6 inches. He was already 6'4", so he's 6'10", and I hated him for that. I remember giving a talk many, many years ago to a church. I said, girls have 90% of their adult height by sixth grade. And she was just a little, she was like, oh, great, thank you. Way to go. Actually, she went here for Country Day. But again, if we recognize where our kids are unique, then we need to view those as opportunities and assets, not as deficits. Because it'd be very easy for them to say, you know, I'm struggling, what's wrong with me? And we know, even on from an educational standpoint,